So this is the project for my remix of You're Perfect, I Hate It, which is a song by a guy called Mickey Valen. So so this is the project. We're looking at 126 audio tracks and 2 auxes. Yeah, looks like it. Perfect. So,
you know, I didn't expect this to be something.
Here in the intro, there's just super basic chords that come from Keyscape. I think, yeah, this is how I organize stuff, by not organizing anything. Sometimes, like at the very end, I'll go through and like name everything and color code everything, but I think it's almost cooler for you guys to actually see like how this works. So yeah, this is the patch for the this guy. Yeah, like Keyscape is just end game for keyboard instruments. So yeah, it's the Planetzero vibe. I can't tell if anything's been changed. Probably not from the preset. It's just like all the presets and everything is just like incredibly good sounding. So that would get mounted down here. And then there's just our vox doing a bit of compression. And we have some this guy, which is just like a little arpeggiator thing. And then some birds in forest down 50 dB. But that is what it is. And then there is one more atmosphere layer as well. Tape echo spring reverb noise, which is just another like noisy layer. I think it's really helpful to have like these kinds of, I mean, if you're not working with equipment that already does these kind of noise things, then I think it's really helpful to add some of this stuff in, especially in intros and stuff, where if you just have like a piano or like a keyboard playing, it will sound a little bit claustrophobic, I feel like, if it's just like a plugin playing on top of like digital silence. So I think it's really helpful to have like, yeah, all kinds of like little foley, like the birds here and little noise. And also, yeah, this like wobbly arpeggiator guy, which also has RC20 on it, which helps it go wobble. Yeah, I think there's something about the human ear that makes you like these little imperfections. I don't know what it is, but like whenever something is like too static for too long time, then it will start to get boring. All right, that's the very intro. Oh yeah, master channel is coming up. I have a list, a bunch of things here written down on my little penguin guy, starting with the guitar chain that I will go through. Yeah, but yeah, master chain is definitely on there. Why sometimes you bounce off your instruments tracks to audio? Better performance for CPU. A couple of reasons. First, yeah, CPU is a big one, but I mean, even this project, a lot of stuff is still in MIDI. So CPU is not a huge concern for me usually. But more importantly, like I can manage the tails of stuff better, especially in a track like this where I have this build up into nothingness. Like, it's really important for me to be able to cut the tails right at the start of the bar. And you can't really do that reliably with MIDI, or like you can automate stuff, but then you might as well just bounce it to audio. Also, I like the consistency that bouncing to audio gives me, because sometimes, like especially with plugins like Keyscape, you have a lot of you have round robin samples, which means you have different samples for the same velocity. So if you play 10 notes in a row at the exact same velocity, it's still not going to sound exactly the same the next time you play those 10 notes. So I like bouncing it down just so I know that it's going to be the exact same thing every time. It's still going to have variations and stuff, but it's just like, it's going to lock those variations down. So then the vocals come in. I didn't get any stems from Mickey. By his own admission, he was too lazy to bounce them down for me. So I only got the a cappella and the instrumental, and that was it. So I didn't use the instrumental because it was pretty like full on produced, and there were no like any bits I could chop out of it. So I just used the original vocal. Vocal treatment is pretty simple because it was already like mixed and stuff. I just have gain plugin to bring it to mono. Yeah, there was quite a lot of like stereo with stuff, but usually I like to keep the lead vocal in mono. And then if I want to add some, yeah, I have like a AMS reverb here on the room setting. I'll add that, but I like to have like majority of the lead vocal in mono. Then tilt shift, just a simple filter down at 181 hertz. Yeah, I'll just use this as like a quick way to cut off the lows. And then here, it's nice because this has like a continuously variable continuously variable filter slope. So I can like, here you can see like, I can change the sort of slope of the filter. Then Soothe, quite heavy handed. Usually I wouldn't go this hard, but because this was already a mixed vocal, I felt that it was kind of harsh in the 6K area. So I will just like, you know, I didn't expect this to be so, like this is what's getting cut out. But this Sunday it'll be 10 months. Yeah, especially like 10 months, and you can tell that like some of the S's and T's are kind of harsh sounding and have these like whistly overtones and stuff. So I just got them out with Soothe. Soothe 2, which is great. And then I have this guy, which is like this weird like tape plugin from this Italian company that make really weird plugins. Like they're great, but they're also like super CPU heavy and unreliable sometimes. Like they can crush your projects whenever. They've been getting a little bit better, but still there's, but for this one I really liked what it did to the vocal, just softening it subtly and like giving it a nicer tone. Onwards. Oh yeah, then there's a snap. Expect this to be something. From the Jengi pack, there's the sample, and then there's just a little bit of sample delay to spread it out, cutting off the lows, a little bit of clipping to turn it down a little, then spring reverb, spring reverb from Logic, a little bit of EQ, just softening the highs a little bit, and then a limiter. Yeah, pretty standard stuff. Yeah. All right. A little bit of like glassy electric piano. Just a little bit of alchemy through Valhalla. Little synth fill. Very standard stuff. All right, then there's the second half of the breakdown. A lot of stuff comes in. So, just this little belly thing. I have a little bit of just some EQ and stuff. And then the keys that already were in there, then bass from Logic's Retro Synth, the Analog Funk preset. Some Juno chords from the TAL Juno, which is amazing. Little RP guy that comes in more fully in the drop section. This synth lead guy. Another synth lead guy, or like, yeah. So they kind of like have this little chord thing going. Yeah, I think like that's actually a good thing to go through. Like when layering stuff, you shouldn't necessarily always try to have like all the parts play a similar MIDI. I think it's good practice to like have different layers playing different things. I think that will help you like come up with richer textures and stuff. So this on top of the chords will sound like this. And the filter on the chords is opening towards the buildup, the end of the buildup. Then we have a little bit of Omnisphere vocals, and that's basically the breakdown. And there's a little kick. And a drum loop from Oliver. All right, some questions, let's see. What's your monitor setup? I see you have some open back headphones. Yeah, so right now I have my Hi-Fi Man Arias on, which are just like these way too fancy open back headphones that my friend Rasmus Faber recommended, or like he did this like crazy big test of 25 pairs of headphones, like getting them from different dealers and returning them, and like just did like a big roundup of all the big ones. And he chose these in the end, and then he had these at his studio, and I tried them out, and I was just like, I gotta have them. They were crazy expensive, like $1,500. But I've never heard anything like them before, and like a headphone that I can actually work with. Like I've tried all the different ones, and like that's the only other ones I could work with are the Odysseys, but they're so heavy that they make my neck hurt. So I couldn't get those either. So yeah. But for the actual monitoring, I mostly use my Barefoot Micromain 35 Gen 2s, which I really love. What else? Seems like you prefer processing more as inserts versus aux bus channel. Yeah, definitely. I mean, I do sometimes, like, I'll go through the drum bus and stuff. Like, I have some stuff in the drum bus, but as far as synths and stuff, usually I won't really bother with bussing them down too much. I do have here, like, I have a bass bus and a guitar bus, I think. And so from time to time, I'll use buses as well, but mostly it's just inserts on track level. So, other elements of the buildup. I mean, that's mostly like just the chords and the filter opening. I have this one. It says dry ice, add delay. I didn't add delay, but I thought it was just fun as it is. Then a little bit like little crash thing. Yeah, then it's just like a little noise thing here, and the kicks sort of hyping up the build up, and then the filter cutoff opening on the Juno. Yeah, and other than that, it's pretty static, actually. There's not that much happening because the vocal sort of carries. Oh, and of course, yeah. Endless smile, because of course. I mean, it's kind of subtle. It's not like one of, like, yeah, it's the most subtle preset, the soft preset. Oh, yeah, I mostly use this one because it's like the only one that makes sense for my kind of music. But I mostly use it for the graphics. All right, Yeah, that's mostly the first breakdown build-up section thing. And of course, like, oh yeah, one more thing. I have this harmonized vocal thing up here. Just to add this sort of vocoder texture there. It's just four little archer boys with a four-man pitch down and the robot mode, which makes it like stuck to one note. And then, yeah, then it's just suspended chord. All right, that's the first 50 seconds of the song. And then we move on to the sort of main section. You're perfect. I hate it. I like the fact that the follower noises are in the key of the song. It's really nice. You're perfect. I hate it. So that's the sort of the main section. Yeah, let's start with the big reveal, which is the fact that even though I played a real Juno in the social media video clip that I did for the remix, it's not a real Juno. It's the plugin. Even though I did start the track with the Juno, like I would just like have the vocal playing in the background and I would noodle around with the Juno. When it came to actually producing the track, I was doing these little like automation things on the cutoff and the decay on the envelope. And I just couldn't get the swells to be perfectly how I wanted. So I just figured like, yeah, it's going to sound pretty much the exact same in the mix as the original Juno. So yeah, I just use the TAL plugin. These are the settings. It's very basic stuff. Just the most classic Juno sound you can have. As far as the processing for this guy, which is, by the way, the MIDI is very simple. Yeah, it's just mostly three note chords. Occasionally there's a couple more as well, but yeah. Processing on this guy, Goodhertz tone control. It is a very simple sort of Baxon Dull, just boosting the highs. Then Native Instruments, 76. For saturation, I'm using this guy, which is really hard to use for some reason. Like it's hard to get the level matching to be right because like the scaling and the knobs doesn't make any sense, but it sounds really nice once you get it set up right. And then this kind of EQ. Like just a bit more like dynamic boosting up here and then just some slight moves to like, yeah, get away some of the honkiness at like 600 hertz and then a little bit of impact at 1.2K and then kickstart to get it to sidechain to the kick. All right, so bass. Oh yeah, so there's actually an example of a situation where I would freeze something because of the CPU, because yeah, Duo can be really, really heavy on CPU, so I'm not gonna unfreeze it because then probably my computer will melt. But yeah, it's very simple stuff. Just I think it's, yeah, there's the name of the preset on Diva and then probably just edit it a little bit to be a bit darker, and then there's just a bunch of little moves on compression and stuff. But what we can see is the bus treatment. So I have this second bass line coming in on the second half of the drop section, which is a bit busier just to keep some movement, but I felt like this second pattern on the main bass line was probably a bit too busy, so I still wanted to keep the energy up, but without cluttering the low end too much. So this was the solution that I came up with. So there's another, I copied the probably copied the same Diva patch here and then just some different processing, taking off the low end and adding a vowel filter with Serum FX, which is usually what I use for vowel filtering. And then all of that goes through this bus where there's a bunch of EQ. Just, I can't tell you why. Oh yeah, this is just like 12 dB cut at 200 Hertz. And then inflator, just a bit more saturation from Goliath. And yeah, that's the bass. So the bass and the synth together sounds like this. Is this preset a default of the plugin? Yeah, for Diva, yeah, it is. Then we have this wobbly ARP, which I think is a pretty important element, even though you can't really hear it. Or you can hear it, but like it's kind of subtle. It sort of like gives the track a sense of movement. So that's just the Serum preset. It looks like it's a Fabian Mazur preset. Yeah, Vital Serum presets by Fabian Mazur. And then it's going through some RC20 and Valhalla DLI to sort of make it move around like that. Then I have this guy, which is baritone guitar, I think. Just doubling the bass. It's very subtle in the mix, but I just wanted to have something doubling the bass where it just gets a little bit wider without actually making the low end wider. All right, so there's the bass with the baritone guitar. It's kind of subtle, but I think it's nice to add in some of more human elements in a track like this. Oh yeah, there's like a little synth thing here on this, which is again the Tal Juno. Do you see a pattern here? And then Echo Boy doing like this is preset I have called Nicerizer, which is just a diffusion delay at 0 milliseconds. So it just sort of like breaks up the sound nicely. So this is without it and this is with it. It's just like, yeah, makes it like wobbly and nice. So yeah, I use that quite a bit actually to make things that are too in your face to sort of spread out. And then there's Decapitator. Drums next. All right, so that's the drums, or like the starter drums. Pretty basic stuff, actually. So this is the kick drum. It's from an older remix I did. Yeah, I was probably just stuck when I was starting this remix and didn't know what to do. And I thought might as well just drag in some drums from older tracks and see what's what. So yeah, this is from the remix I did for Saint Busse called Breathe. And also the looks like the snare is from that one as well. Yeah, I think it's good practice to save all your, like when you're done with the jack, export all the drums as waves. Because then like if you're getting stuck, then you have at least like a bank of things that you know worked. Because yeah, with this one I was probably stuck and I was just dragging in some older drum samples and seeing what would work, and then this did. And they don't sound nothing like anything like the Saint Busse remix because of the track is like the track is so different. So I don't worry about that too much. Yeah, the snare is just this. Then clap from the Jingy pack again. Just a simple, like a very tight. Yeah, it says old school and it sounds like that as well. What else? Then there's an Oliver loop, because everybody uses Oliver loops. Yeah, it helps a lot. Who am I kidding? Yeah, what I did though was, yeah, clip it at 18 dB. So I'm only getting the sort of, I'm not getting the super crazy like clicky transients that they have on these samples. I'm just getting the sort of like tone and the little fills and stuff, like this reverse stuff. And then there's this loop, which is another sort of atmospheric loop, which I think, like, once again, like having stuff like this in the background, I think helps a lot in tying, like basically like making the, you know, drums feel more like a drum set instead of like just a collection of samples. Then there's just some random percussion stuff, open hats, very basic stuff. And that's everything for the drums. Yeah, I have checked out the new Oliver pack and already like downloaded like 300 things of it. Yeah, it's incredible once again. The guy is on another level completely. Right. So that's all the drums. Then the drum bus. Okay, so just the UAD Ampex tape machine. It's not doing a ton. Like you can see here, the views are not like smashing hard, but I still like it. It also adds a little bit of noise. I don't know if you can hear that. But yeah, once again, just like piling on these little things that sort of like make it sound more like a record. Then this, I only use it for the high-pass filter. The high-pass filter on this one I find is really nice because it has like a little resonant bump. So it cuts everything starting from 54 hertz, but it also boosts around the cutoff frequency. So I get a little nice boost down there before it cuts everything below that. Soothe. Wow. This once again is pretty wild. What am I doing? All right. For some reason, I thought removing this was a good idea. This might have been like me putting Soothe on the master and seeing like what it cuts away, and then realizing it's mostly drums, and then just putting it on the drum bus. I can't tell you. And then more clipping. I use the Air Windows AD clip because it's easy and lightweight, and it sounds good enough. But yeah, so that's the start of the drop section. Oh yeah, there's a little reverse thing coming in here as well. Somebody mentioned it in the chat. It's just the reversed kick from the MDL sample pack. Yeah, so I like using like roomy, flabby kicks like that for reverse effects. It just gives me like a nice little suck into the main section. Oh yeah, then we get into the guitar. Let's stop there. And the guitar that I'm playing is this guy. It's like a super cheap. Actually, yeah, this is a good first guitar to buy. Brand is called Vintage. Yeah, the model is V6. And it's just a really nice basic Strat. I think it's like $300-$400, really solid. First instrument, if you want to get like a really nice one from the start, it has like Wilkinson parts and stuff. So yeah, this is what I would play the main part on. Yeah, straight into the interface. Let me actually see if I can get the same tone as I used on the record, on the spot. So you can see it, but I have Universal Audio Apollo Twin here on my desk. So I'm just going straight into that one. But then I will also... the Fender from UID. And then after that, just a Distressor. And that's my guitar tone, like, most of the time. Yeah, someday I'll make you guys watch 2 hours of me trying to play my favorite songs on the guitar, but that's not today. So here is the guitar riff. So yeah. Almost. Yeah, so that's the guitar tone. So yeah, I usually just have a guitar plugged in all the time and ready to go on these settings. Then what else? I have the Electra. Once again, just taking away some of the low frequencies. Then the AMS, the UAD AMS, which is like my favorite reverb on the room B1 setting. Yeah, there's something about the AMS that just always seems to work. Like, if you listen to it by itself, it doesn't sound that exciting, but like just the way it combines with the original signal, there's something magical about it. And then just a little bit of high cut here to get rid of some of the higher fizz. And then the thing that a lot of people have been asking about is the vocoder. So here we go. This is the vocoder, which is the Logic Evoke 20 polysynth vocoder, which is just the stock Logic vocoder. There it is. On its own, it sounds like this. So I have the guitar without the reverb on a separate track, also a limiter on it to sort of shave off the peaks a little bit, because this can sometimes get a little bit spitty on the transients. Then just some sample delay to spread it out, the Tal chorus, more Juno. On its own, it sounds like this. With processing, I have some like dynamic EQ on the mids as well to just sort of make it sit a little bit nicer. So that's the guitar, more or less. Yeah, I think there's something cool about the fact that like the riff itself moves around a lot, but the vocoder stays the same. I also tried following the riff a little bit more on the vocoder, but I thought it was cooler with a static chord, because it will still follow the rhythm of the guitar, but having the harmony stay the same, I think, is cool. Guitar, bass, some more dynamic stuff, some compression on the, yeah, Logic stock compressor, some Kramer tape, which I probably just use to soften more of the peaks. Some kickstart, not 100%, because the guitar lands on the beat quite a lot, so I thought it was important to have it breathe a little bit more. Let's look at the chat. Have you ever produced other genres but never released any of those? Yeah, I mean, I do a lot of different stuff for different artists. Yeah, you can look up my credits somewhere. I do a lot of songwriting and producing for other artists as well. Like, that's sort of my main thing. But for the Leno thing, I definitely want to try to keep it like on a certain vibe. Where did you learn to how to play and improvise funky jazz chords on piano? Can you advise for beginners to start improvising and create these chord progressions and melodies? Yeah, I didn't really have like any formal education on the keys per se, so I'm probably not the best person to ask, but I think like just the like learning your favorite songs basically, I think, is the best way. Just sort of like figuring out what the chords do. For me, a big influence has been Prince as far as those harmonies go. So just learning those section by section, and you don't even need to like necessarily learn to play them on the keys first. You can just like sort of maybe draw out the MIDI, or if you know how to do musical notation, like write them out. But yeah, I think that's the best way to like learn from songs that you like, and that's how you start to find your own voice. Do you have musical education? Yeah, I do. Not like high level stuff, but I did start playing guitar, like classical guitar, when I was 7, and then like it I took some music theory classes and stuff. But yeah, a little bit, but I don't think any of that is necessary for starting to produce. Can you achieve somewhat the same quality with a different interface and other alternatives for UID plugins? Yeah, absolutely. For me, it's mostly about, like, it's not so much about the quality of the plugins, even though there's some, like the AMS, I don't think it exists anywhere else than on UID. But mostly it's just the fact that I can plug in my guitar, have all my plugins ready to go. I don't need to think about anything. It's latency free and it's rock solid. So, but it, like, you can for sure get the same end result with native plugins. It's just a little bit more work to get it to work, like, as far as latency goes. And especially in a big project like this, like, when there's a lot of plugins and stuff on it, I think it's better to offload the tracking DSP to, like, a separate piece of hardware. Are most of your funky classic chord sounds created by yourself, or do you sample them, whichever it is? Could you show us the process and how you would go about this? Yeah, so on this one, for example, it's just like, yeah, I did it myself, but this one, of course, it's a bit more simple because it's just a Juno sound. But yeah, usually I'll make the samples myself and then sort of, like, chop them up in a different project. I did this on the very first stream I did, but I'm not sure if that's up still. So I think Twitch takes everything down after 14 days. So, but you can probably find it somewhere online. Can you name some of the songs you co-produce for other artists? You can look them up on Tidal and AllMusic and stuff. Look for Leno Linjama and you will find things. Leno, can you tell us about general panning that you use for different instruments in the track? I mean, like, for electronic music, I'm not super huge into panning. Like, most of these elements in the drop section are just all dead center. And I like to get my width more using, like, doubling and chorus and stuff like that, as opposed to, like, having things in separate places in the stereo field. I mean, drums are sort of panned out. But even here, like, some of the hats are still in the very center. So, but there's, like, tambourines on the sides and stuff. So, but yeah, for me, it's mostly about, like, just getting the center to be as solid as possible and then, like, getting the width from whatever needs to be done. For some reason, on electronic music, I can't really rock with, like, too weirdly panned stuff. It's easy to get, like, very unbalanced. Do you have no extra sub bass? No. I'm not a huge fan of using sub basses for some reason, like, especially on Diva. Because there's, like, probably, like, two or three different oscillators, so they're all going to phase with each other and get a little bit of, like, this detuned effect. It's hard to couple that with, like, a separate sub layer as well. Or then, like, you could take away the lows of this one and put, like, a separate sub, but then you would lose the sort of warmth of this, like, slight chorusing that you get from the analog style oscillators. Moving on. All right, so more, one more layer. I don't know if, like, I can unfreeze this. There's probably a reason why it's frozen. Maybe some of these plugins are, like, heavy. But the flanging effect comes from Metal Flanger, which is, like, a waves plugin that I really like. And then there's just some distortion and artwork from compression. And yeah, I think the original sound we can take. Oh, we can't. Maybe we can. Yes, we can. So there's the original sound. Probably a Keyscape sound once again, but then just chopped up and processed. Sort of like a French house-y flanging there. Just another texture to keep it interesting. Some more drums come in, nothing too crazy. Well, that's actually interesting. For some reason, I didn't cut the lows on this one. Probably liked the way it faced with the original kick. So Yeah, I have all these like little banks I've collected over the years on EXS, so I'll just scroll through them until I find something I like. Yeah, so this is actually a good point to talk about layering as well. So I have a bunch of drum layers and stuff, but the actual sounds themselves are pretty simple and solid. I think that's a good approach to have like a simple and solid bass for the layers, and then like you can go crazy on the actual layers themselves. So there, vocal comes back in, same treatment, nothing crazy. Chords drop out, drums keep on rolling, mostly as before, just some of the hats and stuff. The clap drops out, so it's like the drums tone down a little bit. Some reverse things, crashes, effects, system overload, our old friend. All right, people are once again asking about the master channel. Let me talk about the master channel for a second. On this one, sadly, I won't be able to show you the overstayer modular channel, but I have the overstayer modular channel patched in. This gray guy. Yeah, you definitely don't need this, but this is just what I have. I love it. It's just like you basically have filters, EQ, compressor, saturation, and it just sounds super nice. Yeah, let me demonstrate what it actually does. Compare it with and without. So this is without. This is with. Yeah, it's a pretty big difference. So basically what it is doing is, yeah, boosting some of the highs, pretty heavy compression as well. But the cool thing about the modular channel is that you can have it have the compression in parallel. So you can have pretty hefty compression, but still dial in the dry tone back, and then you will get sort of like a nice medium. And then after the modular channel, I have the Manly Massive Passive, which is another UAD plugin. Just slightly taking away some of the like mid frequencies that I didn't like. And then a very subtle shelf at 16K just to open up the highs a little bit. And then I have the inflator, which is like a wave shaper, saturator kind of guy. Which is also boosting the level for I don't know why. I guess I was just boosting some of the level on that before hitting the limiter. And then I just have the limiter, which is the Pro L. But I didn't actually, like, when I sent this to mastering, I took the Pro L off because it doesn't make any sense to, like, smash it with the limiter because the mastering guy can't do their job then if it's already, like, limited to death. But I did leave the inflator on, probably. I think I did because it was just adding some things that I liked, and I did bounce it through this master chain before sending it to mastering. Yeah, so that's the master chain. We can do one more comparison with and without it. With it. One more thing to note is that I would probably add these pretty early on in the process. So I was mixing into them. So it's not like my mix sucked until the very last moment and then I just added this in and made it sound nice. it's rather like at the very start, I was just sort of like, when I had a basic groove going, I would add this in and to like just to make it move the way I want it, and then I would carry on working. Sometimes I don't use anything on the mix bus. I just rely on buses and stuff to get the movement I want. But on a simple track like this, where there's not a lot of things fighting for attention, I think it's nice to have a bit more heavy-handed approach with the mix bus. What did you do before you got the upper gear? One thing that sort of does a similar thing, actually, is the Waves Greg Wells thing. So the Greg Wells tone-centric and the Greg Wells mix-centric. These are sort of just like one knob things, but Greg Wells made them, or like they were made with Greg Wells, and he's a great mixer and an all-around great guy. I trust his ears more than I do mine. So like literally just doing... Obviously, like you can't really like EQ with this. It's more like just for like getting everything to sit in a package. But I think they do a really good job of like getting that sort of gluing effect. So there's a saturator and then there's like an EQ compressor kind of guy. So that would be my recommendation. I use this still quite a lot, especially when I'm traveling and stuff. There's a wow guitar here somewhere. Yeah, there we go. Essential. Second breakdown, mostly the same as the first breakdown. There's new layers. This one called Paskasuna, which is Finnish for shitty synth. Yeah, it is very shitty. But it's just another texture to add a little bit of hype into the build-up. One more. All right, so that's the Arturia CMI, which is the Fairchild emulation that they have on the ensemble setting, which sounds like this on its own. Yeah, the interface is wild. It also makes these key press sounds when you press on the keyboard. And then you can like actually go in here and like edit stuff, but I mostly just use the presets because who the fuck has time to go through all of this? The processing is just a bunch of weird Air Window stuff. Shout out Air Windows. They're like all free plugins, which all look the same. And the guy who makes them is a little bit crazy, but he makes crazy good plugins, so go check them out. So that's the processing. And that's mostly everything that is new. There's some, like a white noise thing coming in. Very standard. One more. Just a bit of good old white noise. Are they really good, these Air Windows plugins? You have to try them, like each of them out almost individually, because like some of them do really weird stuff, but some of them do really interesting things. So I just have like some of them in my Logic like specialized folder, and I just try them on, and sometimes they work and sometimes they don't. But I think it's important to have like plugins where you don't exactly know what you're gonna get, because then you can just like be pleasantly surprised sometimes. I hate it. So that's once again the harmonizer thing I did with Little Ultra Boy. Four tracks of Little Ultra Boy tuned to different notes, and then just some Maserati guitar. I like using guitar plugins on things that are not guitars. Both the CLA and the Maserati things just do nice things and everything. How do you find her and other artists to remix their songs? For this one, they just reached out to me asking if I want to remix it. But of course, like, that's off stuff I've done previously. I think it's just like, at the start, it's important to like just find artists who are sort of at a similar level, where you sort of click artistically, and then you can do like remix reps and stuff. That's how I started out, like just like finding people who would dig my stuff, and then like we would like trade remixes and stuff. So I think, yeah, finding like-minded artists. So yeah, this is sort of like the high point of the track. Like, everything builds up, like the kick does like this triplet build up thing, and then we bring back the guitar and like some more stuff, like this little pizzicato string. I just love pizzicato strings way too much. And like little high layer for the synth as well, just to open it up a little bit more. I feel like maybe I could have added a bit, like, an even bigger one there, but I think it's also kind of cool that it's kind of chill, even though it's like the last big moment of the song. Adding a high octave to the guitar. Just bounced down the original guitar and added like a sound shifter thing, and then just some more processing. There's like an arpeggiator thing coming in. One more layer for the chords. ride. Oh yeah, this is cool. There's like a fill that I have here. So I just bounced this at a very early stage, I can tell, because the mix sounds different. And then I will just put it through some distortion. Or actually, let's see. First I'll put it through, oh yeah, these guys. So I stopped trash on the old tele preset, which does this. Then I have a transistor radio preset on the Space Designer, which is just like what it is, transistor radio. Impulse, then Sooth, doing Sooth things. Prowell, softening the transients. Com filter from the Logic fat effects, and then that goes in here where I have some like make it mono and add some big crushing from this guy, which is another crazy plugin that I don't know how to work with. So yeah, this just you can use it as many different things, but I just use it as a big crusher here. So yeah, the track goes very tiny for 1 second and then it comes in full power again. Yeah, the outro is just more of the same, more or less. I think we're getting to an end point. Let me look at the chat more. Oh, a pretty big processing for such a small effect. Yeah, I mean, but I wanted to like hit just right, and I find that like if I just put EQ on it, it's still gonna have like this crazy like the dynamics of it still feels too big, so I need to find ways to like sort of shrink it down so that the track can really like close and open again. So, I mean, there's probably like some of these aren't absolutely necessary, but I still like putting in the stuff in there. Can you do a breakdown of the technical single remix sometime? Yeah, that would be great actually, because it's another pretty simple one, so it should be easy to go through. Yeah, I'll add that to the list. I'll try to make this project breakdown thing maybe a weekly thing, but at least like a couple of times a month. Just because it's so easy and fun and stress-free, and it seems to be interesting to you guys. So yeah, let me know if there's any other tracks you'd want to hear and go through, because this is fun for me. I also like, it's very interesting to see like choices that I've made in the past that I would not necessarily do today. What else? What shampoo do you use? I can tell you actually. I use the Lush. I can't tell what it is, but it's like the purple shampoo. Daddy-o. I use Lush Daddy-o. Yeah, because that's what Katrina, my wife, gets us. Oh yeah, guys, please support this channel. Yeah, actually, I was supposed to talk about that as well. So I just got affiliate status on this channel, which is something that I didn't know existed, but now I have it, which means that you can like subscribe to this channel and cheer, so financially support these streams, which would be great, because like the more people do that, the more I can do this instead of real work. So if that's something that tickles your fancy, please do that. But I'm definitely not gonna like do anything like put anything behind any paywalls or anything. But it's just a way to like share the love if you have the means to do so. Also, I have some ideas how to like make the subscription worth it. For example, like I was thinking about the demo feedback thing. That could be something that would be like for subscribers, because otherwise it's going to be like too many things for me to go through. But I think like the keeping that as like a perk for the subscribers could be a nice idea. So look out for that. The only thing I hate this first symbol next to my name. I know, right? Yeah, I haven't like, I still need to read in more into like how to customize everything and get like custom, like, I think emotes they're called. The sort of like things that you can put in chat and stuff. Yeah, so I need to figure all that out. And like I said, like, don't feel any kind of pressure to get into the subscription thing yet, because it's still like very early days, but some people asked for it and some people are already joined, which is amazing. Thank you so much. That like, yeah, it's an option that's going to be there from now on. Will you ever play a show, DJ thing or whatever in Sweden? I've played in Stockholm once. I hope I will come back sometime in the future where people can dance again. I hope that will become a reality. Yeah, I think that's everything for today. Thank you everyone for tuning in. Thank you everyone for being so nice in the chat. And once again, it's incredible that people from like all around the world are gathering around my computer screen to look over my shoulder and seeing what goes on here. Yeah, that's everything for today. Thank you so much. Take it easy and peace out.